webinar, and I'm going to play the music.
You want to come in here, Donna? Good evening. The Maple Valley Creative Arts Center is pleased to present the virtual world premiere of The Gift. Thank you for being here tonight and for your support of local artists. You join us from across the United States, across 5 time zones, and it's later than you think in New Jersey, so let the show begin. Thank you. The Gift, a one-act play by Ed Corrigan. Setting, the Philadelphia, Pennsylvania home of William Cole. Time, the present, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. Scene 1, scene opens in living room. There is a work table with a clay bust sculpture atop. Sculpture finishing tools are placed around carpet on a drop cloth. A suitcase is near the front door. There is an apron jutting out towards the audience down center stage, where the apparition of Camille appears. Time is Christmas Eve afternoon. Jake has arrived from his home in Pittsburgh for a holiday visit.
Have a seat, brother. Oh, that feels good to stand up for a minute.
That's got to be like what? Like a 7-hour drive?
Well, about 6 hours. Then how much traffic on the turnpike and no snow in the Poconos.
You want some water, Jake?
Oh, no thanks. I'm good.
Oh, why didn't you fly?
I bought a gift for Dad that wouldn't fit on the airplane.
Oh, do you need help bringing it in from the car?
No, the gift is the car.
Wow. You're giving Dad the Mercedes?
Yep.
But, wow, I thought you loved the car.
I don't want it anymore.
Why not?
I use mostly public transportation these days. You know, good for the environment.
That's a big change for you.
Yeah, things change.
True, but surprising. I mean, don't you think the Mercedes is a bit much for Dad?
Eh, he can have it. Yeah, what did you get him?
The sculpture on the dining room table.
Looks like Mom.
It's because it is Mom.
Why don't you and Dad have a tree?
I don't know. We haven't gotten around to it.
Too busy doing nothing?
Well, let's go get one. Yeah, you know, Dad might like it. The decorations are still in the attic.
Would that make you sad, Michael?
Sad?
Because Mom's not around.
She died over 3 years ago.
Seems like yesterday.
I miss her, but mostly past the sadness. How about you?
I'm fine. How are you doing?
Good.
Really? Seems like you're stuck in the past.
Why do you say that?
You still live here with Dad? You're kind of pathetic.
You left town because you weren't happy.
You don't have a job and he supports you.
I have my artwork.
Which doesn't pay.
There's more to life than money.
Yeah, try living without it.
You expect Dad to live by himself? You know he's had a tough time making it by himself. Don't you think I'd like to be on my own?
Oh, just take it easy. What's keeping you here?
Reasons. Dad was upset when you moved away.
He never said anything to me. We all move on sooner or later.
Not me.
That's my point. You need to stand on your own 2 feet.
How's your life?
Oh, same old, same old.
Hey, how is Jessica?
Oh, we broke up.
Oh, when?
Right after Thanksgiving.
Sorry to hear that, man. You were together for what? 2 years?
Yeah, almost.
Oh, you seemed happy.
Eh, ain't no big deal.
Seems like a big deal. Do you want to talk about it?
No.
Merry Christmas Eve, honey.
Mom? Well, what's happening?
We need to finish decorating the tree before dinner.
Right, Mom.
Come on. Let's get to it. Look, Jake, all we have to do is put this angel in her proper place.
Atop the tree?
Bring the chair over and hold it steady so I don't fall.
I'm tall enough to place her up there myself.
Since when did you get so tall?
Since another lifetime.
You seem so grown up and handsome. How are you, son?
Yeah, not good. My girlfriend broke up with me.
What happened?
She said I'd need to change.
She'll regret it. You're a complex person. Others don't know you like I do. She's not good enough. You have more smarts and more good looks than anyone.
So you've told me many times. Yeah. I'm scared.
Fear is a fleeting moment in time. Let it go. Feel better?
No.
Put the angel up where she belongs. Okay? Bye, honey.
Mom, don't go. Help me.
It will all be okay. You'll see.
What? Don't leave me.
What?
Nothing.
Oh. Dad just texted me. He says he'll be home at 8 for dinner. Oh, and he says hi.
Seriously, Dad communicating. That's strange.
He's making an effort to be more sociable.
How's he been more sociable?
In small ways.
Like what?
Like when he asks how I'm doing, he doesn't turn away before I answer.
Oh, that is different. What else?
He sits and takes a few minutes after dinner.
What does he talk about?
Well, he asks about my day and sometimes my work.
Does he talk about his day or work?
Bits and pieces if I ask the right questions.
That's hard to believe. He used to sit silently through dinner, then spring up like a jack-in-the-box and we wouldn't see him the rest of the night. His idea of conversation was pass the potatoes, please. Sure as hell isn't any different to me.
You're not around much. Maybe if you visited more than once a year, then you'd know what's happening around here.
Once a year is all I can stomach.
Look, he's trying to loosen up. It's Christmas Eve. Give him a break.
Why the change?
I'm not sure. He seems less sad about Mom's death. He's reaching out. Maybe he needs us. Like you said, things change.
Not Dad. He's a mess. You can't fix him. You need to have your own life and leave him alone.
Like you?
Like me.
Alone.
Lights out. End of scene one. Scene two. Scene opens with Jake, Michael, and William sitting at the dining table, which has been cleared of dishes. Time is Christmas Eve, 10 p.m.
Oh, great dinner, Michael. You're getting to be quite the chef.
Oh, he shops for fresh food every day.
Not like he has anything else to do.
I enjoy cooking. Mom passed along her secrets before she passed. Don't you notice the similarities between my cooking and hers?
I do. It's kind of creeping me out. It's like she never left, but I did. Seems you're taking Mom's job of taking care of Dad.
Oh, she did a great job caring for you and your brother.
She was a great mom. I'm just saying she's gone, but the household dynamics haven't changed. Michael tends to your every need. That's the way your life has always been.
Michael has not always taken care of me.
But somebody has.
You don't know anything about my life before your mom.
Right, because you've never told me anything about your life. You've only talked about superficial things, like you had a nice family and a nice house, and how so very nice for you.
You know I'm a private person.
No kidding, and I'm your son. Tell me one real thing about growing up.
This is getting intense for Christmas Eve.
I'll tell you something about me you don't know. My father was a drunk. He beat me with a belt.
I had no idea. I'm sorry that happened to you.
No wonder you never talk about your childhood. Sounds like a nightmare.
Oh, well, it was a long time ago. I spent a lot of time in my room reading.
Well, this explains why you still spend so much time alone in your room.
My work room?
Whatever. It seemed like you were always in there when we were growing up. You never took time to play with us in the backyard.
Oh, I was working to provide for the family. It's what parents do.
It's not normal for one parent to be absent.
I was here.
Physically, sometimes, but not in any other way. Sure as hell was not a normal life.
What's a normal life?
Not what you're living. Being a servant to a socially inept parent.
You're bitter because you aren't happy with your life.
I feel so damn stuck.
Ugh. Well, you said I'm the one who's stuck.
Look at how dysfunctional this family is.
We're getting along just fine. You're the one who's struggling.
I'm fine.
Then stop all your complaining. Things were peaceful until you showed up.
Do you want me to leave?
That's not what I'm saying. Look, all families have issues. Can't we just talk about things without attacking each other?
Well, like normal people?
I guess.
What a joke. When Mom was around, we had a chance of being normal, but even then we couldn't get it right.
Couldn't get what right?
Life. Like, we didn't talk about what was bothering us.
Like what?
Or what was wrong with us.
What's wrong with us?
Something is missing.
I don't understand.
Look at us now. Here we are, just the three of us. No friends, no other family. Alone on Christmas Eve. How messed up is that?
Well, look, we have each other.
Shut up.
Thanks for dinner, Michael. Good night, boys.
Oh, sure. Run away and hide. Williams M.O. There he goes into his hiding hole. Run, rabbit, run.
What was that all about?
The truth.
It sounds like whining to me.
You were always the favorite, the good son.
So now it's my turn on the grinder, is it?
Why not? The truth is...
Time for more of Jake's truth. When you turn truth into a weapon, is it still true?
Oh, there you go with your nonsensical interrogatives. You were big on that crap when we were teenagers. I remember once when you asked, why is there air?
Oh, and you answered, air is for footballs and basketballs, idiot. Jake the jock, huh? Good at any sport, including sports that aren't sports.
What's that supposed to mean?
I mean, like, how you treated girls, for example.
Hey, they were attracted to me.
Yeah, until they got a taste of your verbal venom, then they ran for their lives.
Yeah, my mouth is still my worst enemy.
More truth from the sayer. Yeah, I do miss when we were young and close. You were my hero. I was your shadow. Man, what happened to us?
Well, you decided to stay here as Dad's chef sycophant, and I can't respect you anymore.
I think it happened when Mom died.
What does she have to do with it?
You were her favorite.
Because she only had the two of us and no favorite.
Oh, but Dad did?
You always were and always will be his favorite.
That's how you chose to see things. You don't know him at all.
Of course I know him.
You don't understand him.
He's a self-centered bastard.
You were definitely Mom's favorite. She loved how you were. always the captain of whatever team you happened to be on at the time. She went to all your games. She loved when you turned on the charm, as you do, like with a flick of a switch. She loved how you protected your little brother. And she loved you more than anything. And I've made peace with it.
How did you manage to make peace?
It's all about pain and acceptance and counseling. Mom was flawed like everyone else.
I miss her.
Me too. Especially this time of year. Remember how she sang Christmas carols in front of the tree?
I do.
Yeah. Well, it's a long day for both of us, bro. So I'm going to head up to bed. Mm-hmm. See you at breakfast.
Good night.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the treetops glisten and children listen to hear sleigh bells in the snow. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, with every Christmas card I write, may your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be white.
Jake collapses to the floor, lights out, end of scene two. Scene three, Christmas morning. Jake, Michael, and William are seated at the dining room table. They have finished breakfast. Plates are cleared. They are drinking coffee.
Merry Christmas, boys.
And a cheer for Michael's gourmet breakfast.
Oh, how magnanimous of you, brother.
Yeah, crepe Suzette flambé and Francaise fraise a la creme is pretty amazing. I had no idea you really had mom's kitchen magic.
Well, thanks for the compliment.
It is Christmas Day, so don't get used to it.
Jake, the snake can strike at any moment. Hiss.
You guys stayed up late last night, catching up on life?
And reminiscing about mom.
Yeah, we talked until I collapsed.
Like, I miss her too, especially this time of year. Camille went all out at Christmas to make things perfect.
Perfect?
Well, she tried for us.
Surprised to say, hear you say you miss her.
Well, why shouldn't I miss her?
No, you should. I just never heard you say it before.
Well, you're not around much.
Jake's right. I mean, I never heard you say it before either.
Well, of course I miss your mother.
I figured you felt that way, Dad, but you don't talk about it.
Well, you know how private a person I am.
Right, you are a private person. Uh-huh. We are your private family, so how about telling us a story about you and Mom?
No, I have to leave soon for work.
Can't you take one holiday off?
Oh, the holidays are the best time for special maintenance projects at the museum.
It's Christmas morning. Can't you be late? Come on, talk to us.
About your mom and me.
About anything, for Christ's sakes.
Okay. Well, your mom was the only one who really knew me.
We know you.
But not in the same way.
What do you mean?
She knew me completely, like no one else.
Hey, how did you two meet?
We met at a movie theater showing Romeo and Juliet. She was sitting right behind me. At the end of the movie, Camille was standing up clapping. I was stunned. Why are you clapping?
Why not?
Romeo and Juliet just died.
Tragic.
Yeah, tragic. So why the applause?
Well, such beautiful deaths deserve praise, don't you think?
And what?
What happened next?
Nothing.
Nothing? Was it one of those love at first sight things?
Probably.
You're the worst storyteller ever.
I need to get ready for work.
Oh, not until we open presents.
Right.
Well, hell, there ain't no cowboy shootout here, boys. Somebody make the first move. Pathetic. You two are gift morons. All right, fine. I'll start.
You start.
All right. Merry Christmas, Jake.
Oh, awesome. Steelers tickets for the final season game. Thanks, Michael.
I know you've become a steelhead.
Unless they're playing the Eagles, the eagle will never die.
Amen to that, bro. The eagle will never die.
No. Merry Christmas, Michael.
Well, roll over, Beethoven. Season tickets for the orchestra. Thanks, man.
I figured you'd like those. They're doing your favorite next month. Mahler's number one.
Oh, hell yeah. The Titan, as good as it gets.
Merry Christmas, boys.
Let me guess, a Macy's gift card.
Nope.
It's not a gift card?
It is, but from Amazon. Thank you.
Wow, Dad. So 21st century of you. Thanks.
Okay, Dad's turn. You go first, Jake.
No, you go first.
Oh, saving the best for last, huh?
Whatever.
All right. This is for you, Dad.
Oh. Oh, my. Oh, my God. It's beautiful. It's so beautiful. She's so beautiful. Camille.
I'm glad you like her. She still needs a few finishing touches.
Thank you, Michael. This must have taken some time to sculpt. How did you hide her from me?
Really, Dad? How much do you realize what's happening around here?
You're right. I guess I don't notice much around the house, our home. I'll try harder.
You are trying. I'm not complaining. Just an observation, since we seem to be communicating on different level.
Yeah. Communication. I'll try harder.
Don't hurt yourself.
Okay, Jake. You're up.
Merry Christmas, Dad.
What's this?
Your Christmas present. The Mercedes parked out front.
Well, I thought it was your car.
Don't you like it?
Well, of course I do. Well, thank you, Jake. It's generous of you, but
what?
Well, it's too expensive.
You deserve it. You're still driving the old Chevy. I made big bucks in the stock market this year. I can afford it. Just live it up for once in your life.
Well, I hardly drive the Chevy. I take the bus. It's free for seniors.
You don't like my gift.
No, that's not true.
Oh, now we're telling the truth in this house of lies. Huh, I'll give you some truth. You've never appreciated anything about me. You thought I was wasting my life playing sports. You never came to any of my games. You never even drove me in your stupid cheap-ass Chevy. I had to bum rides from the other parents. Sometimes they said no. I hid out for hours and then came home without playing. It was humiliating. When it came to Michael, you drove him to the studio all the time. You neglected me, and now you're rejecting me. I can't do enough. I can never be enough.
You're right, Jake. I should have been a better dad. I'm sorry.
Sorry? You admit to everything. Unbelievable. Too little, too late. Go to work. And don't worry, I'll be gone by the time you get back.
Lights out. End of scene 3. Scene 4. Scene opens with Camille and William on the stage apron.
Camille. I don't see you for 2 years, and now twice in 2 days.
Do you see me? Really?
I think so. Don't I?
I'm just having a little fun with you, darling.
You always do that. Where have you been?
Here, there, everywhere, but mostly close by.
I miss you. Thus, from my lips, by thine, my sin is purged, my Juliet.
Then have my sin that they have took, my Romeo.
Our most favorite movie. I love you. I'm lonely without you.
I'm right here. I love you. We pass. Love remains. How are you?
Well, not so good. I have one son who hates me.
One out of two is not bad in my book.
It's easy for you to say.
You think it's easy for dead people to talk?
Is it?
Some days are better than others.
Tell me about it. Jake's so mad at me, I don't know what to do.
Talk to him.
Well, I tried. But the more I say, the madder he gets. I've been a terrible father.
Well, you aren't the best, but I've seen worse.
Thanks for the support, I guess.
You're too hard on yourself.
Well, what should I do?
keep your feet on solid ground so you're able to be of help. Jake will come around when he needs you and you'll be there for him. He'll eventually get over the anger.
Mm. What about you?
What about me?
Will you get past your anger?
My anger is in the past. Death dealt a new hand.
So no resentment that I kept you from your career?
I made my own choices. When Jake was born, we both decided I'd be a stay-at-home mom until he got settled into grade school, and that was great. And then 7 years later, surprise, along came Michael, who, don't get me wrong, is wonderful, but was not a part of the plan. And then my stay-at-home job was extended indefinitely.
Well, I should have done more so you could have gotten back to the theater.
I had a stage manager job offer when Michael was 1 year old.
You never told me that.
It was my own fear that kept me from taking the job. I felt no longer capable.
Oh, you would have been terrific.
Thanks. It was my choice, but I blamed you.
I remember all too well. It's a relief to hear you say it wasn't all my fault.
I didn't say that. You were part of the problem, but it was mostly my doing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I forgive you.
Thank you, my love.
Merry Christmas, William.
Merry Christmas, Camille.
Well then, my dearest, time flies, as do I.
I would I were thy bird.
Sweet, so would I. Good night, parting is such sweet sorrow.
Lights out, end of scene 4. Scene 5, Christmas Day, afternoon. Michael is seated at dining table, putting finishing touches on the bust of Camille. Jake enters and sits across the table from Michael.
Hey, get any sleep?
No, been thinking.
About what?
Dad.
Why don't you cut him some slack?
He's a prick.
You can see he's trying to change, but change is hard, man.
Pathetic.
You're overreacting. I warned you the Mercedes was too much.
It's about me, not the car.
He told you the truth about the car. It's a thing. You're a person, his son. He loves you. He's trying to open up to both of us.
I thought he was going to cry when you gave him mom's sculpture. Anyone could see he loved it. When I gave him the keys, he looked disappointed. More than disappointed. He looked like he bit a lemon. How can anyone prefer a $50 sculpture to a $50,000 car?
Whoa. $50 sculpture? I put mega hours work into it. You have no appreciation for art.
Whatever. I'm thirsty. How about a beer?
Yeah, sure. What? You're drinking beer?
Yeah.
Since when?
I don't know, a month ago. What are you, a cop?
No, man, I'm worried.
So I have a few beers sometimes. What's the big deal?
A few beers? You? That's a first. You drank until you passed out.
That was a long time ago, and I've changed.
It wasn't too long ago when Dad and I checked you into treatment. I was there to during your recovery, and I know how it works. You're screwing up big time.
It's no big deal.
No, we need to talk to Dad about it. He stepped up the last round. He paid for treatment.
Yeah, but he never showed up while I was in there.
I did every Sunday, and he did the best he could so soon after Mom died. He was hurting, too.
He has no respect for me.
You can't save your ass and your face at the same time.
You're just like him. Cold-hearted.
And you're just like Mom, a drunk.
Shut up. Mom used to have a drink or two, but she wasn't a drunk.
Hi, honey. How was school today?
Being a frosh is like starting all over again.
Yes, you were big man on campus last year in eighth grade. It is like starting over again. You'll be back on top before too long. Just be you and you'll be the popular boy again.
Is it important to be popular, Mom?
Oh, I think high school is more fun that way. The other kids will look up to you and want to hang out. You'll be invited to all the best parties. You'll always be included and not left out.
Were you popular, Mom?
Oh, sort of, but not like you.
Like me?
It comes naturally to you. You're a born leader and as handsome as they come. People are drawn to you. Let them come.
I don't know, Mom. People always seem to want something from me. It wears me out. Sometimes I wish everybody would just leave me alone. Is that wrong?
Not wrong. It's just you were born to be a leader, and leadership carries a burden. Most people are lost. They need someone to show them the way.
The way to where?
That remains to be seen.
It's too much for me, Mom. I don't know where I'm going, so how can I lead others?
The truth is, they need you. People are mostly a herd, blindly wandering off the cliff, unless they have a leader.
I don't get it. Doesn't seem like high school will be fun at all. Maybe I'll be the one falling off the cliff while the others wander off happily ever after.
Your father and Michael will be home soon. Go upstairs and get your homework done, and I'll finish getting dinner ready.
Mom drank because of her lousy husband.
So she shut herself off from us because of him?
I don't know.
Do you remember anyone tucking us in at bedtime?
It was a long time ago.
After dinner, Dad was hiding in his workroom. Mom was passed out by 8 p.m. We were on our own most every night.
Mom is not the problem. She loved me. Dad made his choice, and it's not me.
Are you talking about the gift?
The gift is a metaphor.
You're not a metaphor.
My whole life is. This family is a nightmare.
You should be thankful for what you have.
I only have things, worthless things that give no meaning. I reach into myself and come up empty. I'm angry, I'm sad, I'm fed up, I'm not important to anyone. What's the point in living?
I love you, Jake.
Because of guilt.
Guilt?
You're my brother and have to love me, but there's nothing to love.
Can't you just accept that Dad and I love you?
God, what happened to me over the years? I used to be fun, happy even. Ran away when Mom died, never came back. I feel useless.
You're tired. Why don't you go sleep for a while? We can talk more when Dad gets home.
I don't want to be here when he gets back.
You can't go anywhere without getting some rest, right? Just go lay down, okay?
Okay. I'll have another beer to help me sleep.
Damn.
Lights out. End of scene 5. Scene 6. scene opens with Camille and Michael on the stage apron.
It took you long enough to come see me, Michael.
I wasn't sure what to say.
And now you know.
Yes, Mom. I love you.
I love you. I'm always close by. How are you?
I'm okay. Can we talk about Dad?
Sure.
Why did you ask me to take care of him? Why not Jake? He's the oldest.
You're more giving than Jake. You have more in common with your father. You're the strong one in the family.
But what about me?
What do you mean?
What about my life? Maybe I should have moved on after high school, found a studio in New York City where I could make my art.
You're making art.
Yeah, family bus, but I want to do more than that. I want to be on my own, to make my own art.
But what would happen to your father?
He can take care of himself.
You promised to take care of him. A promise is a promise, Michael, especially on my deathbed.
I did promise, but I didn't mean forever.
It won't be forever.
He's not an invalid. He'll survive.
Survive, yes. But have a full life, no. He's totally dependent on family.
Aren't we all?
He's an extreme introvert. You know that. He doesn't have any friends. And what about Jake?
What about Jake?
Jake is struggling and he needs you too.
There you go again. Laying your guilt trip on me. You're the one who left. You're the one who's guilty.
How can you say such mean things to your mother?
It's the truth.
I was sick.
You gave up.
That's unfair. The cancer was not curable. I could not accept the poisonous treatments they prescribed just to prolong the agony. Maybe I made the wrong choice.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to question your choice. The truth is, you asked too much of me. I'm trying, really trying. Dad and Jake are grown-ups. They should take care of themselves. Yeah, Jake says he's stuck, but I'm the one who's stuck.
The family needs you.
I need to live my own life.
I know you, son. You'll do the right thing.
Right.
Lights out, end of scene 6. Scene 7, Christmas night, William enters from front door. Michael is sitting at the dining table.
Sit down, Dad. I've got some bad news.
What happened?
Jake relapsed.
Today?
No, he said a month ago, but I'm not sure I believe him.
Why not?
Because his life is really screwed up and he lies when he's drinking.
Where is he?
passed out upstairs. He drank after you left for work.
How much did he drink?
I already told you, he passed out. We don't have time for 20 questions. Listen up. You know the drill. I need you to engage. Jake needs you now.
So, what, we need to get him into treatment?
Yes.
When?
Right away.
Doesn't he have to return to work tomorrow?
In a drunken confession this afternoon, Jake said he lost his job.
Oh. When?
And his girlfriend. He's going down fast, Dad. This is urgent, life-threatening. Do you understand?
Well, yeah. Should we check him into the same treatment center as last time?
Perfect. Do you still have the number?
I do. I'll call tomorrow.
No, you need to call now so we can check him in tonight. Make the call.
All right. Okay. Hello? Hi. Yeah, this is William Cole. You treated my son Jake a few years ago. Well, he's relapsed. Would you happen to have space for him? Oh, okay, I'll hold. They're checking on a bed. Hello? What? You do have a bed? Oh, okay, good. We'll see you in a bit. Yeah, Merry Christmas to you too. All right, we're set. Let's go get him up.
Before we do that, there's something else we need to talk about.
All right, treatment's like $10,000 a month, but I'll figure out how to cover it somehow.
That's good, but not why we need to talk. Mm-hmm. It's about what Jake calls our household dynamic.
Oh, can't it wait till after we get Jake checked into treatment?
No.
All right.
Jake thinks you don't respect him.
That's not true.
He thinks I'm your favorite and you don't love him.
Of course I do. How could he say these things?
I'm just telling you what he thinks so you can deal with it.
What am I supposed to do?
Talk to him for starters. But the bottom line is, you need to step up and be the parent in this family.
Well, I'm not sure what you mean.
I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. You do the best you can. You've been trying harder to be part of things. This is a crisis. You've gotten stronger over the past year. Take life to the next level. We'll get through it when you take the lead. Carpe diem. This is your moment to get out of yourself.
Well, what should I do?
Do the next indicated thing.
Oh, help me out here, Michael, please.
Next thing is, we take his sorry butt to treatment, uh-huh. and you've already set that up. So how will we pay for it?
Well, I don't know. I'll figure that out.
You pay for it by selling your Mercedes parked out front.
But Jake got angry because I didn't really want it.
He gave it to you. It's yours. You don't need it. His addiction is going to cost us another $50,000. You're the leader of this family, so you do what's best for the family.
Sell the car.
Carpe diem.
Well, what if Jake gets angry?
Who cares? I wouldn't tell him until he gets out of treatment, right?
Yeah, all right.
I know you can do all these things, all right, Dad? Somebody else was always responsible. Now it's do or die for you.
Why do or die?
I'm planning on moving to New York City.
What? When?
As soon as I can find an apartment.
Oh, why are you leaving? Is it because of me?
I need a larger scene to explore my art. Well, come on, Dad, say something.
I don't know what to say. I'm shocked, and I'm just trying to process. Give me a minute. I'll miss you, Michael.
New York is only a 2-hour drive.
But it won't be the same.
Nothing stays the same. And I'll miss you too.
I like having you here with me. Is that selfish?
No. I like being with you too. Time has come for me to move on. I need to have a life of my own. Do you understand?
I do understand. Truly, I do. I was the same at your age. I just woke up one day and knew I had to move on. I get it. You're not a kid anymore. You have real talent. To be honest, I was kind of surprised you stayed after your mom died.
She asked me to stay and take care of you.
Oh, no, I can take care of myself.
Not back then.
When did she ask you?
On her deathbed. Literally.
Oh, sorry. I didn't know. It was wrong of her to ask you that.
It's in the past. Dad, you must know Mom enabled you and you enabled her.
Oh, I don't see that.
She took on both parents' jobs and you overlooked her drinking.
I'm not so sure.
Think about it. Can you do the other things we just talked about?
I guess I don't have a choice.
Okay. Well, let's go drag the drunk to rehab.
Lights out, end of scene 7.
You better watch out, you better not cry. You better not pout, I'm telling you why. Come on! Santa Claus is coming.
Epilogue. Christmas Eve, 1 year later. Michael enters through front door and puts his suitcase down. Jake greets him with a hug.
I still have to get used to all this hugging stuff around here.
The time has come for change.
Hey, where's Dad?
At work, of course.
On Christmas Eve? Some things don't change.
1 year ago today, you were right here greeting me, remember?
Oh, I tried to forget, but can't. That was one bad holiday. You've come a long way, big brother.
Daw. And look at you, a real live New York bohemian artiste.
We've both been through some major change.
The irony kills me.
Hey, do you want to take a walk down to South Street Grocery? I'd like to pick something up for dessert.
Hey, you don't have to make a trip. Dinner is a done deal. Dad cooks breakfast, and I do all dinners.
Whoa, that's great. Say, what's your favorite dinner to make?
Anything coming out of a can without using a can opener. I hate those gadgets. I always get it about 3/4 of the way open, then have to use pliers to finish the job.
Okay. I'm looking forward to an interesting meal. And it sounds like you and Dad are having have things worked out.
What things?
You know, living together things, like sharing the cooking.
Oh, well, you don't know the half of it. We can hardly get through a meal without arguments or, at the very least, profanity.
Oh, sorry.
No, man, it's all good. Dad lets me have it when I do something that pisses him off. He talks to me, even yells sometimes, but now I know he knows I'm alive. You know what I mean?
I do, major pain in the ass brother of mine.
takes one to know one. Merry Christmas, Michael.
Merry Christmas, Jake.
Lights out. End of play.
You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Come on. Santa Claus is coming to town.
Hello? I popped myself out there. Can you hear me?
Come on back, Dad.
How do I get back here? Oh, here we go. Hey, let me introduce our brilliant actors. And we have Lindsey Dabek played Camille. Give a shout out for Lindsey.
Hello.
Zach Dunn played Michael. Thank you, Zach. Shout out.
Thank you.
Ryan Asbert as Jake. Hey, nope. Jake. And Dean Moody as William.
Thanks very much.
Great job, everybody. And thank you to our audience for coming. Sorry, I blipped out there for a minute. I push the wrong button sometimes. But we're going to stick around for a few minutes for anybody that'd like to hang out and do a little chatting with us or have any questions or just want to say hi. So we'll be here for a few minutes, and thank you so much for coming.
Yes, thanks very much for being here. That's great.
Yes, yeah. I think we wound up with probably 70 to 80 people in the audience.
Wow.
Which is really great for our little art center, because our art center only holds 60, so we're over capacity.
Nice. That virtual thing makes it possible for people all over the world to come listen to us, come see us.
That's right. We should maybe ask our audience, feel free to pop up in chat and let us know where you're tuning in from tonight.
Oh, yeah. It'd be great to hear from people.
Excellent idea.
Oh, I see some really nice comments. Thank you. Thank you to our audience for the comments. I hope you can see those, Ed.
I can't see the comments. No, we're.
Don't worry about it. They're all.
Oh, I got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Some relational. I like that.
Nice comments from everyone. If people are not familiar with Maple Valley Cultural Arts Council, I will pop up your website.
Okay.
Oh yeah, I was going to add any. Upcoming stuff you'd like to plug?
Yeah, we have we do the last Friday of each month with Midnight Mystery Theater. We do live mystery comedy plays on the last Friday of each month, and that's so that the next one's coming up, I believe, is March 26th, and then we plan on having more drama. A drama series of one acts through the rest of the year. We're still working on that right now. I don't know if we'll do those monthly or maybe quarterly. And then we'll have a children's play coming up in the summer that we're gonna co-produce with the city of Maple Valley, and do that at there's an amphitheater, natural amphitheater in a park close by. So we're going to do that this summer, and this month at the Arts Center is everything's virtual. We've been shut down for a year, and our revenue streams have been hurt. But we keep our costs low because we're all volunteers, and we have a good leader that's frugal with everything that we do, and. So we're steaming through this COVID, but we sure miss seeing our audiences and having our actors on the same stage. So it's been a real learning experience with Zoom. So we've learned quite a bit, and I think some of it will probably stick with us, and some of it we'd be glad to let go of it. Oh, there are lots of nice comments coming in there, huh? Yeah. Wow, thank you very much.
Yeah, we have a couple pop-ups in the Q&A. Marcy Johnson says, thanks for a really interesting play. And she and Joey are tuning in from West Seattle.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. Hi, Marcy and Joey. Thank you so much for coming. It was great. You guys have been long-term supporters of mine, and I just appreciate the heck out of you.
I'm not sure if you've been seeing all these lovely comments, Ed, to you, but I'm going to try to save this chat so you can review these later on. Okay. Since they're going a little fast, but
there's one from my friend Lolly in Hawaii that was a very nice comment. We worked on this play together at the Freehold Theater. She was working on her play, I was working on mine, but we're in a writer's group with Elizabeth Heffron, working on it together. So that's, I saw her, I saw a piece of her work a week or so ago that was up on the Freehold Zoom platform. So shout out to Hawaii.
Wow, that might be our Hawaii.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder if that's the furthest listener. Is Hawaii our furthest listener?
Well, we have New Jersey, we have Hawaii.
Oh, okay.
There's a lot. We have
California. Yeah, one of our performers in California. That's nice.
Yeah.
Texas.
Performing from a distance.
Yeah. Yeah, we had some.
And by the skin of his teeth, no less. Good job there, Zach. Great job.
Thanks.
Wow. Okay. I finally got to chat. Holy cow. Thank you for so many comments. It's awesome.
Is that wonderful?
Thanks, Joe, for your comment. Very nice. Thank you for being here, man.
Oh, someone in New Jersey. All right. Thanks for tuning in.
And it's after midnight there. Oh, my goodness. Go to bed.
Yeah. Oh, that's my buddy.
It could be.
Chris wants to. You gotta talk to Dean about the bust. It's
zippy about that. It has a little bit of work left to do, but Zippy wants to. I mean, she had a great time doing this, and wants to actually refine it a little bit more. But no, I think she did it. I think she caught you personally.
She is so talented, and I'm honored.
I'll ask her, Chris.
I don't know if you saw, Ed, but someone just says, who wrote the play?
That was our friend Ed.
That was
Ed Corrigan. I did.
Ooh,
I Carmel. Did, yeah.
Hmm.
It's
Carmel, Indiana?
COVID play.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, actually, I don't know, but there was a comment about a great choice for the narrator. So
nobody else would take the job. Yeah. my friend Helsley, Bill and Kay Helsley from Carmel, Indiana.
Where is Carmel, Indiana?
Near Indianapolis.
Oh, okay.
Just north of it, I think.
I'll be darned. I used to live in Pauline when I was a kid.
Oh, really? Wow. But they have very professional acting. I agree with that. You guys are awesome.
Thank you. Oh, very kind.
Yeah,
it's interesting because when we go through rehearsal, you know, you guys, you know, I don't see your full game until the performance happens, you know. So then it was game night, and it was fantastic. It really was.
It's such a wonderfully written piece, Ed. I really, admire the piece. I really did.
Pop up in the Q&A, Marsh and Liz said, I was happy to see a play again. I thought it worked well. Good to hear more of your work, Ed. Liz and Maple.
Oh, Liz Matheson. Yeah. Hi, Liz. How are you? Thank you for coming.
Oh, here's
the birthday entertainment.
Oh, happy birthday to Diane Carolyn.
Nice.
Diane Soto. Should we sing happy birthday?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday
to you. Happy birthday to you.
Yeah, Diane's been like an echo chamber. Diane's been a supporter of my play since the very beginning.
Well, my mom.
That's really nice.
My mom's been popping up a bunch of very positive comments. Thank you.
Hi, mom.
Hey, is that Linda?
Yeah.
Thank you, Linda, for the sweet comments.
Yeah, she's your daughter's quite the apparition, isn't she? I'll tell you.
That's sweet.
She's a vision.
Oh. So wonderful. Yeah. Gosh. So, you know, this is the only really cool thing about, you know, all of this is that people from all over the country are tuning in and friends and family.
It's true.
Don't even find parking.
No parking.
Yeah, no parking
issues.
No parking. You can wear your pajamas to the theater.
Right. Yeah.
If you want, as long as you stay sitting down, you know. So.
Right.
I don't know if Brenda is still here, but a shout out to Brenda for always being so great about doing all the ticketing and organizing. So, Brenda, I don't know if you're still there, but.
Yeah, she's great. And I don't know if Mary Jean Glazer's still there, but she's the president of the Arts Council. And she's been wonderful to me for the last 10 years. So she, I wrote a play and called The Ave. It was the first one. And I didn't know what to do with it. And I was reading about the Arts Council in the local newspaper. And I went to her and talked to her about the project and she produced it. So it was really, you know, quite a break for me to get the work out there, because I know a lot of playwrights don't have their plays fully staged. And so it's the Arts Council has been really wonderful to me over the years. So I think I have the poster from that. Oh, you can't see it.
Can't quite see it,
but that's the poster. I had the cast and the crew. We had they got a poster and they all signed it for me with that first play. I keep it up on my wall here. So, you guys ready to wrap? Give it a wrap, or things still coming?
Yeah, I think so. It gets us a little closer to the next one. What do you think about that?
I think it's good. Yeah.
I'm looking forward to doing more of these with you, Ed. Seriously.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I would love to work with you, the four of you again too. Yeah, that would be awesome. We'll do that. So I have a couple plays that haven't been brought up yet that need work, and then I have a couple of dramas that we've done once that we'll probably bring back up because John Ruoff is. Promoting the process that we do more drama. And this is kind of nice to mix it up with the comedy.
Yeah. No, I know. I was making comment to some friends that, you know, for the last several years, I've just been doing either old time radio shows, you know, from the 40s and 30s and 40s and 50s, or you know, the MMT, you know, kind of ridiculous comedy stuff. But this was the first kind of straight drama I've done in a long time.
Wow.
It felt really good.
How about you, Brian? You do drama?
Not a lot. I did Death of a Salesman. I was happy. Ooh. So
oh, yeah.
A little more comedic, but still a dramatic dramatic show.
That's an amazing show, yeah.
Usually comedy. Like Boeing and stuff like that.
Oh, okay. Nice. And then Zach, you do drama and comedy, huh?
Yeah, I've done both. It's fun to kind of switch it up or switch back and forth between the two. It's, 'cause you get to try out different stuff. I mean, it's great to get the audience laugh, but also when you do like the serious stuff, you just feel like that, like the pin drop. You know, everyone's like there with you. It's great.
You're working very different muscles, but having some sort of audience effect is pretty amazing. I agree.
So how's it acting without the audience being present?
As long as I have the awesome actors to act against, then I'm
okay. Yeah.
Nuts to the audience, you know.
It really is a different kind of challenge, though, because you can usually kind of gauge some of the pace of it. And even when there are jokes, even with serious ones, like it's tough to kind of do it without like a live audience. So that's a real challenge. And I mean, I know the other actors have been doing a lot more like the radio comedy stuff. So that's like one where like the timing is so crucial to the joke. And even, I remember like the Marx Brothers would actually, for some of their bits, they would go test it on live audiences before taping it, figure out the cadence of it. So
it's a lot that, and it's been interesting too with audiences. It's every audience is different too, you know.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, which is really one of the things that I didn't expect when I did my first play, was how different the moods the audience can come in and how different people can respond so differently. And it tends to, and a couple different, you know, two or three people can affect the whole audience. Things like that happen, you know, it's just spontaneous.
Right.
But
I agree.
I don't know when we're going to be able to open the Arts Center back up, but hopefully in the fall. I'm not sure. Not sure yet. But we won't do it. Yeah. And then we can move our work there, but we could, I think it's still a good idea to do electronic podcasts of the shows so people from elsewhere can have access, and actually people here who maybe they can't come to the theater for some reason, they could participate.
It's good for there to be a variety of ways for people to access this entertainment. That's such a nice from Bill Helsley.
That's right, daylight saving time.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bill. Very nice words.
Thanks, Bill.
Bill's
on top of things out there in Cornell.
Well, I am saving this chat for you, Ed. So
okay, thank you. I can
do that later and see who was here to say hi to.
Yeah, so I can respond back to people. That would be great.
Thanks so much to our audience. Are we ready to wrap up, Ed?
I think so. Yeah, I'm ready. Yeah. I'm kind of worn out here.
This was all right.
You go have a glass of wine there, Ed. You deserve it.
Well, cheers to a really nicely written play, Ed, and to some fantastic actors. I love
fantastic actors.
So easy to say I love you to these actors over
here. Yeah, so I love
cheers.
I love all these
cheers.
Very, very much.
All right. Thanks, Ed. It was an honor.
Yes, thank you, Ed.
It's an honor to work with all of you. Thank you so much. You guys are awesome. Too.
All right, take care.
Good night, all.
One more second. I started getting teared up in that scene with Camille and William. It really got to me tonight. That was just so beautiful.
Oh.
I did. I was like, I was surprised because I've seen it a number of times, but you guys, you just really got to me. So thank you for that.
It was beautifully written. I keep saying that because it just every time I say it, it gets truer. it was lovely. And of course I get to when you're acting opposite Lindsey in a scene like that, I don't think it's possible to not come across well. So
right. Thanks everybody. Good night.
Bye guys.
Good night.
Take care.
Bye-bye.